Blackstone Audio presents The Secret in Their Eyes by Eduardo Sacheri, translated by John Cullen. This book is read by Mark Bramhall. To my grandmother, Nellie, for teaching me how valuable it is to preserve and share memories. Translator's Note. At the time of the novel, the Argentine judiciary was divided into two jurisdictions, investigative courts and sentencing courts. Judges, examining magistrates, presided over investigative courts, and every judge's court comprised two clerks' offices. A clerk employed about 8 people, of whom the second in command was the deputy clerk and chief administrator, the position held by this novel's protagonist, Benjamín Chaparro. A period of great turbulence in Argentina culminated in the so-called Guerra Sucia, the Dirty War, which lasted from 1976 to 1983. During these years, the Argentine state was the chief sponsor of massive and systematic political violence, whose victims included not only members of armed guerrilla groups such as Montoneros, but also students, activists, trade unionists, teachers, journalists, and leftists in general. In such an unstable and dangerous environment, even the basically apolitical Chaparro is at risk. State terrorism in Argentina during the Dirty War resulted in the disappearance of at least 13,000 people. Some estimates run as high as 30,000. Retirement Party. Benjamín Miguel Chaparro stops short and decides he's not going. He's not going, period. To hell with all of them. Even though he's promised to be there, and even though they've been planning the party for 3 weeks, and even though they've reserved a table for 22 at El Candil, and even though Benítez and Machado have announced their willingness to come from the ends of the earth to celebrate the dinosaur's retirement. He halts so suddenly that the man walking behind him on Talcahuano toward Corrientes barely manages to avoid a collision, dodging past with 1 foot on the sidewalk and 1 on the street. Chaparro hates these narrow, noisy, light-deprived sidewalks. He's walked on them for 40 years, but he knows he's not going to miss them after Monday. Not the sidewalks, and not a great many other things in this city, where he's never felt at home. He can't disappoint his colleagues. He must go, if only because Machado is coming all the way from Lomas de Zamora just for the occasion, despite his bad health and advanced age. And Benítez likewise. It's not a terribly long way from the Palermo neighborhood to Tribunales, but the fact is that the poor old guy's pretty much a wreck. Nevertheless, Chaparro doesn't want to go. He's sure about very few things, but this is one of them. He looks at himself in the window of a bookstore. 60 years old, tall, gray-haired, aquiline nose, thin face. Shit, he feels obliged to conclude. He scrutinizes the reflection of his eyes in the glass. A girlfriend he had when he was young used to make fun of his compulsive way of looking at himself in shop windows. Chaparro never confessed the truth, neither to her nor to any of the other women who passed through his life. His habit of gazing at his own reflection has nothing to do with self-love or self-admiration. It's never been anything but another attempt to figure out who the hell he is. Thinking about that makes him even sadder. He sets out again, as if motion could save him from being pricked by the barbs of this new additional sadness. From time to time, walking without haste on that sidewalk, forever untouched by the afternoon sun, he checks himself in the shop windows. Now he sees the sign for El Candil, up there on the left, across the street and 30 meters on. He looks at his watch, 1:58. Almost all of them must be there by now. He himself sent off the people in his department at 1:20 so they wouldn't have to run. The coming court session doesn't begin until next month, and they've already closed and archived the cases from the previous session. Chaparro is satisfied. They're good kids. They work hard and learn quickly. The next thought in the sequence is, I'm going to miss them. And as Chaparro refuses to squelch around in nostalgia, he comes to a stop again. This time, there's no one behind to crash into him, and the people coming his way are able to navigate around the tall man in the blue blazer and gray trousers, who's now looking at himself in the window of a lottery office. He turns around. He's not going. He's definitely not going. Maybe if he hurries, he can catch the judge before she leaves for the restaurant, because he knows she's stayed behind to finish an order for someone's release from preventive detention. It's not the first time the idea has occurred to him, but it is the first time he's summoned the modicum of courage needed to act on the idea. Or maybe it's just that the other prospect, the prospect of attending his own retirement luncheon, corresponds to his notion of hell, and he wants to avoid infernal torments. Him sitting at the head of the table, with Benitez and Machado beside him, forming a trio of venerable mummies, listening to that pathetic De Alvarez pose his traditional question, let's do it Roman style, all right? So that he can spread around the cost of some high-end wine and knock back most of it himself. Or Laura asking everybody in sight to split a portion of cannelloni with her so she won't stray too far from the diet she just started last Monday. Or Varela meticulously descending into his trademark alcoholic melancholy, which will move him to tears as he embraces friends, acquaintances, and waiters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.